everyone. Good morning, good morning. Welcome, welcome to the Lord's house. This beautiful Advent season. Tonight is the third night of Hanukkah. Light in the darkness. And boy, do we need him, right? Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing on the plains and the mountains in reply. Oh,
Amen.
The Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Grace that flows like a river, washing over me. Fount of love, Christ, overflow in me. Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Christ, my Savior. You rescue me. Take this life, dear. Christ my Savior, you rescued me. Like to repeat that first verse. Grace that flows like a river, washing over me. Fount of heaven, love of Christ, overflow in me. Grace that flows like a river, washing over me. Fount of heaven, love of Christ, overflow in me. Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Christ, my Savior, you rescued me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Christ. Christ, my Savior, you rescued me. Here is where I lay down every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay down every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender. Where I lay down every Break up the crowd for my tradition. Break down the walls for my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. Shake up the ground for my tradition. Break down the walls for my religion. Your way is better. Your way is better. Thinking of this song, Making Room, and how appropriate it is for this time of year. And you all know the story of when Jesus went, when Joseph and Mary went with, before Jesus was born, to make room. They went into all the inns in town, and they were told, no, we don't have any room. Keep moving, go to the next one. Maybe they do. We can make room for him in our hearts. Let's not be like that. Let's not be like the innkeeper. Give him residence in your heart this season.
When this song came on, the Lord just clearly just spoke to me and said, you know, sometimes we look for different things for God to do in our life, and we expect it to be a certain way. And I know most of you have seen, like, I always run after Matthew here and there. He runs all over the place. And that sometimes God can be all, do things in different ways. things are messy. Sometimes our life can be messy. You ever hear of the perfect storm? And you think, well, how can a storm be perfect? It's not that the storm is perfect. It's that God is perfect in that storm. It's that we can get through the storm with God. Even though it looks messy, even though our life is messy, even though we may be running around and it doesn't look like it's supposed to look like. We may be going through a trial at home. It may be a financial trial. It may be a husband with our spouse. It may be with our children. It may be in our body. It may be just something we just need from God right now. And we may be saying, I need to hear from you right now. God, I need a word right now. And I'm coming in here and I'm not seeing it. I'm not feeling it. I don't know where else to look, God, but it doesn't look like you're answering me. It doesn't look like it's happening right now. I'm coming into church and I'm doing the right things. I'm going the right things. I'm reading the word. I'm doing everything and it doesn't look like it. Sometimes it doesn't look like it. Sometimes it doesn't look like God is doing something, but he is always doing something. He's always doing something. Even when I'm running around after Matthew and I'm running around and I'm saying, God, like, where are you in this? He's always in it. He's always in it because he's good. He's so good. He's so good. His goodness never ends. He said, goodness and mercy follow us all the days of our life. So when we say, I surrender to you, like, what are you surrendering? What are you actually surrendering? What are we surrendering to him every day? Like, God, I surrender my will. I surrender my ways. I surrender my everything to you because you are my hope. You are my joy. You are my love. It doesn't look like you're doing anything, but God, I know you are. I know you are because you're good. And it may not happen today, but I know you're going to do it. I know you're going to do it. So whatever you're believing for, whatever you're waiting for, whatever it may not look like it, know that he's in it. He's in it. He's in it. He's in it.
Better. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay down. You are all I'm chasing now. This is my surrender. Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and death. Let all within us.
it's Christmas time. It's a special, beautiful time of the year. And it's so good to be out. Welcome to Sacred Exchange Fellowship this morning. Great to have you with us. I have two announcements. I still do Christmas potluck. It's here next Saturday. Okay, 5:30 to 8 right here. Bring a dish and a gift. $10 gift. And that two Sundays from now, December 24th, is our candlelight Christmas service, our choir, our drama, the word, everything. And that's two Sundays from now. That's going to be a special, special day. And I have a word for us this morning. Father, I thank you, O God, for this beautiful day you've given us. I thank you, God, for your goodness to us. I thank you for that you love us and have made provision for us to have everlasting life, eternal life with you, and for your goodness, O God, for that redeeming sacrifice to bring us back into fellowship with you. Hallelujah. I have a word this morning. It comes from Mark chapter 12, verse 1 through 14. There's actually two different stories. Matthew puts them together, and because they have the same wording, they have the same theme, the same message. And I want to look at that this morning. The title is Lawful, it'll eventually get there. Is Lawful. And I didn't take the offering. Ushers, come right up forward. Come on, guys. You can do that later. Come up here. All right. Father, we ask your blessing on this offering in this day, in Jesus' name. Go ahead. There we go. Okay, now that we're off to a running start. Lawful is a sermon, and I'm going to read it. I'm going to go ahead and read it. But first I want to ask you, are you doing your Christmas shopping? Is your Christmas shopping coming along well? No. Wow, you know, I usually do mine like 2 days before. Right. I get the card the day before, and I'm there with like four other guys, and we're looking at the last cards that are remaining, and we're looking at each other, and like, we're here again, you know? But this year, I have all my Christmas shopping done. Ooh. And, you know, it makes it so much easier when you know the person you're shopping for and you know what they really like and what they really love, doesn't it? When you have to shop for someone that you really don't know, you don't know, is this good? Do you think they'll like this? You think they'll like that? You don't really know. But when you know them, when you know what they like, what they love, when you know the person, it makes getting something for that person so much easier. And that makes me think of what it is to please God. What makes God happy? What do we know about God that his love towards us and how we relate to him is easier if you know him? And if you don't know him, if you think that God is some meanie throwing lightning bolts from heaven and desiring for you to fail and making things hard and causing all kind of calamity, then you don't really know him, and it's harder to relate to him. Let's read this passage in Matthew chapter 12, verse 1 through 14. At that time, Jesus went on the Sabbath day through the corn, it was actually wheat, and his disciples were hungry, and they began to pluck the ears of corn and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, "Behold, your disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon the Sabbath day." But he said to them, "Have you not read what David did when he was hungry, and they that were with him, how he entered into the house of God, and he ate the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither of them that were with him, but only for the priest? Have you not read in the law how that on the Sabbath day the priests in the temple, they profane the Sabbath and are blameless? But I say to you that in this place is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, 'I will have mercy and not sacrifice,' you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath." And when he was departed from there, he went into their synagogue. And behold, there was a man which had a withered hand. And he asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? That they might accuse him. And he said to them, what man shall there be among you that shall have one sheep, and if it falls into a pit on the Sabbath day, will he not lay hold on it and lift it out? How much more then is a man better than a sheep? Wherefore is it lawful to do well on the Sabbath days? Then he said to the man, stretch forth your hand. He stretched it forth, and he was restored whole like the other. And the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him. I want you to notice four words in this. Two were used by his opponents, by the Pharisees, and two were used by Jesus. In verse 2, it says, behold, your disciples do that which is not lawful upon the Sabbath day. And Jesus said how David went into the house of God and he did that which was not lawful for him to eat in verse 4. In verse 9, and when he was departed, he went into their synagogue, or verse 10, and it was lawful. They asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? And then in verse 12, wherefore is it lawful to do well on the Sabbath day? Excuse me. That word lawful, back and forth, lawful. The bouncing back and forth of it. And it makes me think of, because I know I've learned a lot of folks, we're governed by a law mindset. We look at the letter of the law and not the spirit of the law. That's what these Pharisees did. What was created first, humans, mankind, or the law? People. The law was created a long way after. What is more important to God, the law or those people? The law came to make people understand who God is and what God requires and to help us to please him. People didn't come to fulfill the law. The law came to edify people. The Pharisees had a way of looking at this that people are expendable. People are not important. What's important is the letter of the law. And keeping it in its exactness is what's all important. And the people, they're not important. Jesus came to show the exact opposite, that people are all important, and the law came. The law is not unimportant. I know I'm going to get in trouble. Someone's going to take what I'm saying, throw out everything that they don't like, and have me saying that we don't go by law, we don't have to live right, you don't have to live righteously, none of that. I'm not saying that. I'm saying Jesus recognized that it's people that are important, and the law came to make our lives fulfilling and right before God and righteous and wonderful, not to persecute us, but to elevate us, not to put us down, but to lift us up. And so a right understanding of the law is what the Pharisees lacked and what Jesus tried to show them in these two stories that Matthew puts back to back. Let's look at it a little deeper. Two perspectives, law and lawful. Mark 2:27 says the Sabbath was made for man and not man for the Sabbath. Man was not made for the law was made for man. And I look at the juxtaposition. If you look in Matthew, and you look at chapter 12, we all know the last verse of chapter 11. When Matthew put this together, I think he put these two stories right here. Never assume chronology, especially in New Testament. It's not chronology. He puts stories where they go to create a narrative. Can I read you the last three verses of chapter 11? Right? It says, come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. I am meek and lowly in heart, and you will find rest to your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden light. And then we come to Matthew chapter 12, and then we come to a story of the Pharisees giving people a hard time about their adherence to the Sabbath day, who weren't even guilty. So Jesus just gets done saying, my burdens are light. And these Pharisees, who Jesus will say in another place, are laying burdens upon people that they can't even bear themselves or won't even attempt to bear themselves. And he's walking through the wheat fields with his disciples, and it is the Sabbath day, and they reach down and they grab a little scoop of grain. You ever do that with grass? You grab the grass and all the little seeds come off the top. I love doing that. And only this was wheat, and they would roll it in their hand, which that was harvesting. Rolling it in their hand was technically processing it, right? It would be like the thrashing, and then blowing the chaff off is the winnowing. So they're like guilty of harvesting, processing, eating, and who knows how far they walked. If it was beyond a Sabbath day's walk, they're guilty. According to the law, they're guilty. They harvested on the Sabbath day. You can't do that. They processed the wheat into something edible. You can't do that. And so the Pharisees are, how come your disciples are doing this? They're breaking the Sabbath. We should just stone them right here, and you for allowing them. You're the rabbi. Well, how come they're doing this? And he's like, don't you understand? You don't understand. Is it lawful for them? Is it lawful? That's the question of these two sections. Not is it right. Not is it lawful. Are you breaking the letter of the law? And by the letter of the law, I suppose they were. And what Jesus is going to show them is it's really not about the letter of the law. It's about the spirit of the law. It's why God gave the law. God gave the law of the Sabbath, not for man, or for man, not man for the Sabbath. The Sabbath is a day of rest and a day of recognition of God. Do you think God needed to rest on the seventh day? He could have created everything twice as big and done it all over again on one day. He only took six because he felt like it. He didn't do it because he was restricted. He didn't need rest. We need rest. Have you ever worked a month, 7 days, for a whole month? I did it. I was foolish. I was young. They told me, oh, you're doing so good, and we have no one else, and you have to do this because we can't do it without you. And I'm like, oh, you puffed me all up. And I worked a month straight, a lot of 12-hour days in them, and I was frazzled. I was burnt. We're not designed for that. We need times of rest. We need times to recuperate. We need times to get aside and focus on God. And that's for us. And I like to eat on Sunday. The Sabbath is Saturday, technically, we know that. But for me, mine is Sunday. And I like to go after church and eat. And these guys were on the Sabbath, they were walking through the field, and they were hungry. And so they grabbed a little, and they're making something, and they're eating as they went. And they're coming under the condemnation of those who... I've learned some folks love condemnation. They were harvesting, they were processing, they were preparing a meal. They were technically guilty. Technicalities and interpretation. It brings me, I told someone this morning when I was smelling some delicious food out there, when we're talking about food, technicalities. And some people look to find things on you. And so I thought about when I would make shrimp scampi. And of course, when you make shrimp scampi, you melt some butter and you get some garlic and you get it melting. And then you have to put sherry in it. And so I would go into the liquor store and I'd buy a bottle of sherry because it was cheaper in the liquor store. And I'd get sherry that tasted better. And so I'd always walk in and wonder who's going to see me walking out of the liquor store with a brown paper bag twisted on the top. And I'm like, no, I'm going to be in trouble. But I can buy sherry, cooking sherry, even though it's not as good, at the market, right? I can buy it. But all right. But what about, Shana, when I have to make some nice rigatoni with pink vodka sauce? Now, you can't get that at the market. And I've tried making pink vodka sauce without the vodka. Because I'm thinking, what, you know, you get the oil, you're sauteing up some nice fine garlic and a little bit of fine chopped onions, and it's getting simmering good. And then you've got to put in, right, you put in the vodka. And then you put in the crushed tomatoes, and you let it cook so wonderfully. And then near the end, you put in the cream, and you've got beautiful pink vodka sauce, right? And I've tried it. I said, what does vodka do to it? It doesn't, shouldn't do anything. I tried it without the vodka. It's not as good. You need vodka to make pink vodka sauce. Anybody like pink vodka sauce with the mackerel? You know, with your veal palm, sometimes it's nice to have that on the side. I'm pushing all the buttons on you today, Shane. And so you can't get, so now you got to go buy vodka. And now I saw Pastor Frank coming out of the liquor store with a bottle of sherry and a bottle of vodka. This guy's got problems. Then there's the story of one of my favorite preachers. He was the king. He was the prince of preachers in the 1800s, Charles Spurgeon. And so Charles Spurgeon had a dispute with another famous preacher of the day, because that preacher said, Charles Spurgeon smokes cigars. Oh, you know. And Charles Spurgeon said, well, you go to shows, you go to the theater. And so they had a big contention over who was, and it's like it made a problem, and they had to work it out. D.L. Moody, another very famous minister, right? He went all the way to England to see Charles Spurgeon because he admired his preaching so much. And when he got there, Spurgeon opened the door to him, and he had a cigar. And D.L. Moody said, oh, what's going on here? I can't believe you, a man of God, would have a cigar. And so Charles Spurgeon went to D.L. Moody, and he put his finger on his ample belly and said, oh, D.L. Moody, I can't believe you, a man of God, would have such an ample belly. I mean, after all, the body's the temple of God. Now, these are all examples of people seeing things. There's an old song, ain't necessarily so. People seeing things and jumping to a conclusion, or looking and judging and trying to find something in someone else. And sometimes there's an old saying, and I've shown it to be so true, so true. Believe half of what you see and none of what you hear, and you'll be way better off. Because in every one of these instances, even seeing something would lead you to a wrong conclusion. I have rocks and minerals. I've always collected them, always liked them. A lot of the kids collect them and like them. I have a spectacular collection, because most of mine are this big, big hunks of crystal, apophyllite, and fluorite, and all kind of crystals and everything. So people would come into my shop, and they were like, oh, I feel the power of the crystal power in this place. And I'm like, these crystals don't have any power. These are sanctified crystals. These are Holy Ghost crystals. The only power in this place is Holy Ghost power. And I can't even go to buy crystals or rock here, because you go into place and it's like all like, but even there, you can't even have a rock collection, and some folks are making it something wrong. Okay. So those are examples of how people can see stuff, but they're not really seeing what they think they're seeing. So Jesus' explanation here, behold, your disciples do that which is not lawful to do on the Sabbath day. In verse 3, and Jesus said to them, did you ever read what David did when he was hungry and those that were with him, how he entered the house of God and he ate the showbread, which was not lawful to him to eat? How about the showbread? The priest, well, let's eat the showbread first. So David goes to the priest. He's on the run from Saul. He's starving. His men are starving. He goes there, and he's like, you got any food? And the priest, I don't have any food. All I have is the showbread, which is sacred, and we have it for a week, and at the end of the week, we take that showbread down. Only the priest can eat it, and we make new showbread, and we put it in the tabernacle. And so David's there, and he's like, I'm hungry. Can you give me some? And he said, hey, I'll give you 5 loaves. It's not lawful for you to eat it. But he gave him 5 loaves. He ate it. And you know why he gave it to him? Because life is more precious than a rule to not eat the bread. And the priest knew this. And David, who was a man after God's own heart, knew this. And he says, so did you read that? That was not lawful, but was it right? Was it lawful or right? It was not lawful, but it was the right thing to do. So that was the first thing he said. And the second thing he said is this, and how about the priests in the temple? Do the priests in the temple do that which is not lawful according to your rules of the Sabbath? Do they offer incense and do all the things associated with that? Do they change the oil in the lampstand? Do they go ahead and kindle a fire on the Sabbath day? Do they do all these things? They're the priest. They do it because it's what they're supposed to do. And then the last thing he does, as he did in Matthew 9, is he quotes Hosea 6 and 6. Says, have you not read? What does Hosea say? That God would rather what than sacrifice? Mercy than sacrifice. So he's not saying, he's not disputing, look, we pick stuff. We picked wheat, technically. We processed it, technically. They're hungry. He's saying there's a reason that we do this. And you guys are looking at and nitpicking stuff. You're taking stuff that you're making things wrong that are really not wrong. That's what he's saying. I look all the time at the woman in John, the woman taken in adultery, in the very act, it goes on to say, in the very act. Was she guilty? Absolutely. She's guilty can be. And they take her to Jesus, and they're looking to, they think they have him on the horns of a dilemma. And all he does is, he doesn't say, he says, okay, the law says that the witness should throw the first stone. So which one of you witnesses has no sin, let him throw the first stone. And they all bail out because they know they were all full of sin. Did he ever say adultery is not a sin? Did he ever say the woman wasn't really in an adulterous situation? Did he ever say it's okay? It's okay. God is love. Don't worry about it. It's all for, he didn't say any of those things. He never said the woman was not totally guilty and totally deserving of being stoned. He just says, okay, there you go. Who's going to throw the first stone? She obviously is guilty. The law says she should be stoned. You caught her in the very act. So who's going to throw the first stone? And they all walked away. This is what he does here in the second account. Verse 9, and when he was departed, for the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath day. And verse 9, and when he was departed from there, he went into their synagogue. I always find it so interesting. It's all through Scripture, their synagogue. And there was a man which had a withered hand, and they asked him, saying, is it lawful for thee to heal on the Sabbath day? See the term? Is it lawful? Is it right according to the law? Just like the last one. Is it right according to the law that your guys pick? And he said, well, is it lawful what David did? Is it lawful that this guy to heal on the Sabbath day? They knew he was going to heal this guy. You know why? Just like you know what to buy someone for Christmas because you know who they are. They knew who he was. They knew he wasn't leaving this guy crippled in that place, and they knew it. And so before he healed him, they jumped in and said, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? To try to make him a hypocrite. He's like, I'm not a hypocrite. I'm the Lord of the Sabbath. And which one of you, if you have a sheep, and that sheep falls into a pit on the Sabbath day, are not going to pull it out? You know why he said that? There were different sects of the Jews. Right? Here we're dealing with the Pharisees. There was a sect called the Essenes. They were the ones up around the caves in Qumran, where they had the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. They were kind of like a sect of monks. They were like separate sect of monks, and they were like, there's not much else written about them. But they had a rule, and their rule is if your sheep falls into a pit on the Sabbath day, you can't touch it, you got to leave it there. And the Pharisees had the rule. They said, well, if your sheep falls in the pit, you can get your sheep out. And so Jesus, talking to Pharisees, knowing they have that rule, says, oh, and they had contentions over this stuff. So which one of you, if your sheep falls into the pit, are you not going to get it out? If we have Essenes here, I'm talking to Pharisees. Are you going to get your sheep out of the pit? So you can pull a sheep out of a pit, but here's a man, here's a child of God, and you can't have him healed? Do you see some problems? Is it lawful? Is it technically okay? Is it okay by the letter of the law to do this, to heal him? Tell me about the letter of the law in your sheep. Your letters of your law, they're crooked. So if you can pull a sheep out, why can't I pull a man out? And so he heals the man. And when he heals the man, and his response is it lawful to pull the sheep out of the pit? If you want to talk technicalities and law and loopholes, God is not so much interested in technicalities. He's interested in them. He just doesn't like them. As he is in the spirit of the law, that the Sabbath was created for man to bless man and help man to live right, because God designed us and he knows what we need. It wasn't designed to hurt. Look, was any of the law designed to hurt? You can't kill people. That hurts me. That hurts me so much. I want to go killing people, Doc, but I can't. Oh, man, I'm deprived. You can't, sleep around, lie. What can't you do? You can't, defraud your parents and be dishonorable to them, disrespectful to them. How does it hurt? How do any of those things hurt? They are blessings. They are blessings to mankind. And they turned it so that they made those to be a curse on mankind. And Jesus is like saying, lawful, you want to talk about lawful? You want to talk about the letter of the law? I have seen this. And there he is. I have seen this where folks turn on each other. And we use the letter of the law to tear each other down instead of lifting each other up. And Christ is concerned. He came here. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Why? Because he loved us. By the way, did he love the world or the people in the world? So, all the guys who are out ready to kill people so that the planet can thrive. He didn't die for the planet. He died for the people on the planet. I figured I'd just throw that in. They looked to tear down and kill. Jesus looked to rise up. They saw the sick as only an opportunity to accuse Jesus. Jesus saw the sick as needing healing. They looked down to kill, and he looked to rise up. Where is a heart Is it looking to kill, or is it looking to bring life? Is it looking to tear down, or is it looking to build up? When we see situations like this, how do we look at it? I'll tell you how I look at it. I look at it, I preached a sermon probably 2 years ago, The Race with Grace. And I addressed that some folks will come into church and you kind of get, you just know, they're here for only a short time. In a short time, something will happen and they'll be gone. Maybe they're easily offended. Maybe they do something. I only have them for a little while. And in that little while, you have to do good. And in a short period of time, what can you do? Can you instill more grace, impart more grace into them, and bring them from here to here? Or do you just lose them? And how much did they gain while they were here in that time? And that's how I look at it. And so folks don't necessarily add up to, this is a pillar of the church community. This is a pillar of righteousness. This is, this, you know, we're doing our elder process right now. As a elder material, living, you know, above the board, they match the standards of an elder. And they're just, or I look at it as like, I want to just see a person go from here to here. If you can go from here to here, that's even better. It doesn't matter. I'm not looking at the end result. The end result's heaven. I'm just looking at how much time do I have? How much influence do I have in your life? And can I get you up upstairs a couple of stairs? It's like the house is burning. And I'm not going to talk about technicalities. And the union rules say you can only carry one person at a time, and you got a room full of people, and the house is on fire. I'm not going to go by what the union rules say. I'm going to grab everybody I can and do my best. And if I can only get you down one flight of stairs, that's fine. We're going to do our best. And it's not about tearing someone down because they're not perfect, because I'm not perfect. I can't throw stones. I listen to that saying, people with glass houses shouldn't throw stones. If you got to let him who's without sin cast the first stone. I don't have any stones to throw. I believe in the law. I believe in holiness. I believe in righteousness. I believe that our whole ability to worship God is dependent often upon our ability to submit to him and to submit to his will for us and to live in holiness and to live in a right relationship with God. But sometimes we cut folks off because they're not to our standard of the letter of the law. And we go beyond that. We pick up a microscope or a looking glass and we scrutinize people to the point where we crush them instead of helping them. You don't have to go all the stairs at one jump. There was a time I would do that, especially going downstairs. Oh, I just do six at a time. Now I like, my knee hurts when I do one. But it's not a matter of doing six at a time. It's a matter of making progress towards God and not looking like, you know. And the other thing it does is it discourages people when I think that I can't be perfect tomorrow, then I don't want to go as far as I can, which is maybe it's one step towards perfect. I just want to take a step every day and do better every day and live closer to God every day. And if I can take someone with me, I'll take you with me. And if you run ahead, God bless you, run ahead. But don't throw stones down the hill at me, because I'm coming up too. That's all I'm saying this morning. Run as fast as you can. Do six steps at a time if that's good for you. But don't throw stones at those of us who are just doing one at a time. That's all. That's what they were doing. It's not a vindication of sin. This is not an excuse or license. This is a calibration of our hearts to his, to love, to lift, and to heal. That's what I intend to do this morning. That's my intent. Jesus healing, when he healed this guy, is it lawful to do well on the Sabbath day? And he said to the man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and it was restored whole like the other. Now, then the Pharisees went out. Mark tells us the Pharisees got with the Herodians, another group. They were people who thought Herod, everything Herod did was great. Because Herod, even though he was a madman and a horrible despot, he was a terrific builder. He rebuilt the temple, or built it up from what it was, the second temple, and he did a lot of building. And so even though he was a madman and a baby killer and all the rest, he had his own party, the Herodians, and they loved him. They were the opposite, pretty much, of the Pharisees. But the Pharisees and the Herodians got together and said, we got to kill this guy. We're going to kill him. It was their, his in their view of lawful, his non-going along with their interpretation of the Sabbath is what caused them to want to kill him. And they conspired together, and from that day, they looked for a reason to kill him. That was what they got out of it. What everyone else got out of it is that he gave some teaching on the Sabbath, and when he gave teaching on the Sabbath that it's okay to pull your sheep out and it's okay to pull a man out, and that God healed this man and he was completely whole. And what that should tell us is that this guy, this rabbi, is telling me this, and that God Almighty is confirming his words, because it's God who healed this man. So this guy comes in and he gives this teaching and he says it's okay. And then God adds his two cents to it by healing the man, and he goes out perfectly whole. That's what they should have got from it. That's what God intended them to get from it. Then I am backing up my son. He's telling you that it's okay to heal on the Sabbath day, to do good on the Sabbath day. You'll do it for a sheep. You should do it for a person. And I'm backing him up because I'm healing this guy. But what the Pharisees and the Herodians and the Sadducees in another place, what they got out of it is, we got to kill him. Because we don't care about people, we care about rules. No, I said that wrong. Belay my that. I'm sorry for saying it that way. We don't care about people, we care about the law. See, when I said rules, that makes it like it's not important. It's just a rule, like doing, what's the speed limit on this road? It's slow, it's probably 35. 25? Yeah, that's it. Put it on about 25, so that way they can get you for 10 over when you're doing 10 under. See that contempt in my voice for those traffic laws? And so when I say rules, I'm implying that the same way. I have great respect for the laws in the Bible. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimonies of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. But it's the misapplication and taking them and breaking out the telescopes and microscopes and looking glasses and trying to find fault in people that Jesus is talking about here. And applying something that God just says you need a day of rest. We've been in Matthew chapter 5 and in the women's Bible study on Tuesday night, and in the men's one on Saturday morning, and our Thursday night service, we're looking at Jesus going over the law and talking about the law and how that you say it's okay, but here's what God's original intent is. You say it's okay. I didn't kill anybody. I just talked them down. I just murdered them with my tongue, but I didn't really hurt them. And it's okay because after all, sticks and stones break my bones, but names will never hurt me. And so I've destroyed someone's character and reputation. I've talked about them and lied about them. And Jesus said, no, you're guilty. And moita, moita them. You killed them to death. I didn't technically didn't commit adultery. I just ogled and lusted, and my heart was full of lust. And he says, you committed adultery in your heart. He's concerned about the heart. And he's concerned about the heart with the Sabbath. And these guys weren't. They're concerned about the letter of the law. He's concerned about the spirit of the law. He's concerned about people more than the letter of the law. And we need to be too. We need to be too. We need to understand what God wants. We need to walk in holiness. We need to understand that the scripture is God's inspired word of God. But we need to understand what God wants for Christmas is the heart of somebody to worship him. He wants us to worship. He wants us to love each other and do right to each other. And he wants us to worship him and follow him. And not do like James says, bite and devour one another. But to love each other and to build each other. When God moves in people, he's showing his approval, and he showed his approval with that man. Be careful what you tear down. In verse 12, how much then is man better than a sheep? Is it lawful to do well on the Sabbath day? And that's how I want to end this. It's lawful to do well on a Sabbath day. Is it lawful to do well every day? It's lawful to do well every day. And that's where we need to be. And that's where we need to be. There's a reason, you know, Jesus was called a friend of sinners. You know why? Because he was a friend of everyone, including sinners. But there's a reason that I don't see any place where he went into like a ballroom, kicked in the door, right? Like those swinging doors in the saloon, right? They probably didn't have those in Israel at the time. Otherwise, he'd have done it, kicked his way in, like two-gun torpedo, and laid them, blasted them all. You sinners, you evil generation. You know who he did that for? He saved that for the Pharisees. He saved that for church folk who got so uppity and pious and looked down on people and stood in the way as somebody was coming up to the altar. They stood there themselves, and they wouldn't go in themselves, and they wouldn't let anyone else go in either. And he saved all his harsh criticism, which was very harsh, for them. And I don't want to be a church people standing in the way of someone else that's his, that he shed his blood for, that he poured out his life for, and stand in the way of them and give them a hard time because you ain't there yet. Now look, if you're not taking a step, if you're going backwards, if you're subverting the community of God's sheep, if you're poisoning the sheep pool, if you're doing things, yeah, I'll break out the crooked stick I got in the office. Look, you know. But we're just doing our best to get closer to God. And we need to get along as long as we're working in the right direction and get there. I want us all to run, but I'd be happy if we're all moving in the same direction. And we shouldn't criticize somebody because you're not as fast as me. You're not doing it right. You're moving with one leg. Look, if I'm moving with one leg, I'm still moving. I might not be moving as fast as Michael can run, but I'm still moving. I want to move with two legs. I would like to. And we want to help each other too. But that's what church is about. That's what church is about. It's about a community of believers helping each other to get further up the stairs with God, closer to God, to work out our own soul salvation, to know the truth, and to love God, and to move in the right direction. That's what it's about. Stand with me, if you will. And from that, they conspired to kill him and sought to find ways that they could. But he asked the question, is it right to do good on the Sabbath day? And I asked the question, is it right to do good on every day? Just to do good. Just to do our best. if you'd like to come up here to this altar and pray, if you'd like to seek God, if you'd like to you know, work through some stuff, you're welcome. We got some elders here that would love to pray with you today. And I want you, the rest of you, to go and just think, how can I help the person next to me? Be a help to them. Get them farther down the road and not hinder them and not be a hindrance. Father, we thank you so much for your goodness. I thank you, God, for your grace. I thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, that you love us more than even the wonderful law that you gave. That you gave it to help us, to grow us, to make us conform to your plan. You gave it to keep us out of trouble. You gave it to bless us, Lord. And I pray that, God, this group of sheep here today, that, oh God, you lead us in the right path, that you lead us in your paths, the paths of righteousness for your sake. Whether it's through the valley of the shadow of death or beside the still waters or into a beautiful pasture, that, God, you lead us and help us to follow. Help us all to keep up and help us to go in the right direction. And help us to be good and act like sheep and not goats. To get along and to love each other. Because you love us and gave yourself for us, and we should love each other for that reason. I pray you have your way with your children here. Heal them in mind and body and spirit. And bless us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ, my Savior, you rescued.